Okay, can you see the screen? Cool.
Yes.
Yeah. So first we discussed with Evtymis what the topics to cover, and it will go in the way like to publish, not to publish, to build the simplest app like from Flutter Create, and then add some build triggers afterwards. Like triggers on pull request and add tests and driver tests and then add code signing and then set up publishing. So in the end, it will be like whole pack of ready build. And CodeMagic, it's Flutter dedicated CI/CD. Since not that recent time, you also can publish other applications, not also Flutter, not only Flutter, but basically, it's mostly Flutter targeted for now. And then let's do the overview afterwards. Now I will just show how easy it's to start to do something. I will just create a simplest app. I put 1, 2, 3 to not repeat the name. And then I will just create a repository for it. Okay. I think it's, yeah, it's done. I'm just going to open the app. And what Flutter creates, there are already tests inside. So it's basically already ready up to do something with it. I'm going to add it to my repository. Okay, that's done. It's already here. Oh wait, I will go to log out. To log into CodeMagic, you can log in with GitHub, GitLab, or Bitbucket. At first, if you do it on the first time, you will need to provide access, basically to agree that CodeMagic will generate or out key for read and write to be able to get data from repository. And then you will log in. So CodeMagic will have access to all of the application on your repository. I have a lot of here. If you want to limit access, it's possible to do from GitHub app, and you just add application from GitHub app without and see all the rest. But now if I will counter, yeah, there is my simple counter application, which I just added to my repository, first commit. It's gonna be the first build. So the first build you can start right away. It will run without tests, and it's going to build everything what you can actually build. But there is no support for web, macOS, and Linux in my application, which is just created. So I'm going to disable it. Use the same Flutter stable. Don't worry, I will go over all the settings a bit later. I will just show that. Basically, I will build Android and iOS. And since I already have tests, basically Flutter added it. I will enable tests. Let's see, for Flutter analyze and for Flutter test. That's a default argument for Flutter test command. Just no need to modify. And we can start the first build. I have only one branch and only one workflow. Okay, so here you can see configuration that which mode and so on, like which version of Xcode and what you actually built. Then when preparing machine, you will see Xcode version and Flutter version and Cocoa pods. Basically, it's initializing step. Then application is fetched from your repository with last 50 commits, like with depth 50. I think it's just a bit slow because I'm sharing my screen. Then for dependencies, we didn't specify any code signing for Android. So default debug key will be generated. As you can see, that's kitl command and just simple alias with history and password. Just something to sign application, but it's not uploaded to anywhere yet.
We have a question. Which Flutter channel will it use?
We use by default stable. Stable is the default one. And then in build, you can use which Flutter version, like basically which channel, or if you want some specific version, you can choose from all of the available ones. The same is Guardian Xcode version and Cocoa Pods version. Uh-huh. Yeah, let's go. In dependencies, there is nothing much, just Flutter packages pubget, and then run Flutter analyze without errors, and Flutter test machine. This machine flag, it's what helps. Basically, the output is going to be in JSON, and then we can parse it this nice result to show. But here is only one test, and it passed successfully. No wonder I didn't break anything, didn't touch. So now it's going to be Android build. There is option. Okay, yeah, I will tell immediately. There is dependency caching. You can cache Gradle and Cocoa pods and maybe some external sources which you need, and it will be fetched on the next build, basically extracted from cache and put to the same folder. Xcode is not that friendly with cache, but for Android builds it works quite well because Gradle initialization takes time, but after cache it's going like very fast, a matter of seconds. Okay, so Android is built. Yeah, you can see which command was actually used. In settings, you said that we didn't specify any other flavors or build number or Xcode schema, whatever, we just use debug, so the command will be the same, Flutter build debug. We didn't specify any code signing for iOS, so there is no code sign. And it means it will be simple app, not EPUB package. Okay, publishing, there is no publishing to external services, only to email, which will came. Also, you can add a Slack to publish. And as I didn't publish to somewhere else, I just have my files. I can download it, install, or yeah, let's see. Basically, that was the first build. It's green. It took 4 minutes for Android iOS, but I'm using Mac Pro. It's a bit faster than Mac Mini. Usually we have Mac Mini machines, and you can purchase Mac Pro for not free. What? Okay. Done with it. Okay. About overview. Here are all the applications which are fetched from a repository. So far, I added only GitHub here, but you also can integrate. I added Bitbucket and GitLab as well. So I have all the apps together. So for these ones, it's not determinate the type. Something is okay, but basically GitHub puts the language which is used in the repository by default. Bitbucket doesn't, but you can specify manually which language is it, Java or Dart or Python, something, and GitLab just doesn't have this opportunity. I mean, it that doesn't have the field which would specify the language which is in the repository. There you can go to any configuration of your application. Builds, that's the builds which were done. You can see last 50 builds. Also, you can download all the artifacts which were generated. You can see which commit was used to build this. Which workflow, and then let's go into workflows. You can duplicate and change different settings, use different workflows. Let's just go one by one through everything. Build triggers use it to automatically start your build on push event or pull request update. Basically, on when pull request build is triggered, like Code Magic will merge the branches inside and will test or will build what is there without the branches actually being merged. So it's quite good for testing. I'm going to show it a bit later. Also, you can specify if it's a source or target branch for pull request, which you want to build. Environment variables, you can add whatever you need, different team ID or some fastline credentials, or like any variables which you want to use, or, for example, Xcode schema. And you can use it into your settings, into build arguments, or you can use it inside scripts, which you can set between any basically pretest, pre-build, post-build, post-publish. For example, if you want to send your artifact to somewhere else. And dependency caching, as I told already, you can specify which folder you want to cache, and it will be zipped and uploaded to gcloud, and on the next build of the same workflow, it will be uploaded, downloaded and extracted. So in many cases, it helps to run builds faster. For tests, there are three tests, analyzer, unit tests and driver tests. There, everything is straightforward. I don't know if you can set a verbose flag or test target something and some of your other arguments which you need. Also, you can use Flutter Drive tests on iOS simulator. It's actually faster than Android emulator because CodeMagic uses virtual machines on Mac minis. Like every build is a new virtual machine is created and it's destroyed after build. So to run another virtualization layer, which is Android emulator over virtual machine is not that fast as one would want to. And also you can use AWS device farm. I will show later how to test on it. And did the same drive arguments which you can specify. For build, you can use this five platforms, or if it's widget, you can just run tests only. Also, you can specify which mode to run. You cannot run in the same time debug or release, for example. So often it makes sense to separate your iOS and Android workflows. For publishing, okay, this two is Android code signing and iOS code signing. I'm going to tell about it later, why it's needed. Then these two about notifications. You can add your Slack if you grant permissions to CodeMagic to post there. And I think, yeah. I will not post anything to Slack. Then this two is for Flutter web, CodeMagic static pages and AWS tree bucket. Static pages, okay, it wants me to enable a web build. You can create subdomain and it will be saved on CodeMagic app. Basically the zip archive of your web app will be uploaded there and you can access it and use. Oh, you can use your AWS tree credentials. Then I will touch later Google Play and App Store Connect and GitHub release. You can publish GitHub release if you have a build trigger at the creation enabled. Okay, let's add some build triggers. I will duplicate workflow and rename it to something. I just pull request test. Let's see. Ah, okay, sorry. I forgot to mention about YAML file. You can configure not only your build settings, you can configure not only in UI, but also in YAML file. If you go here, there is nice information about how to do what. But in general, that's the file which you upload to your repository, and then it's used as a settings. Now it's just mirroring my UI settings. So that's my default key store in script. Here is all the environment which I use and workflow name. And so packages pub/get, enable web, and analyze, test, build apk, build iOS.
Hello?
Yes. Ah,
sorry,
okay.
Sorry, I'm late.
no worries. And then which artifacts to use, and there is my another workflow. What is good about YAML that it allows you to just add file to repository without need to manually configuring everything in UI. You use it in script, and it provides you versioning. So if you change it something, you know what the settings you had in previous build and what is now, what changed it. Basically, you keep the history. And if you need to add some encrypted variables, you can do it here in encrypt environment variables. You can add any file or write your key or something, and it will be encrypted with the key which is generated from your team ID. So you cannot use files encrypted by somebody else from somebody else's account, a Code Magic account. And then you will add it to your YAML file, and it will be read. But okay, what's the notifications? Okay, so I will go to my pull request test, build triggers. I will add master branch as target because I will merge another branch to my master, and will not trigger on push events, but only on pull request, because creating of pull request, it's push event by itself. It's basically commit to repository is new pull request. And two builds will be started. So, okay, I want to run only Flutter test and Flutter analyze. I just want to check that everything is fine in terms of test, and I won't build anything, run tests only. But first of all, I need to ensure that my builds will be triggered. Then I need to go to my webhooks and see if they're enabled. Like sometimes it happens that GitHub doesn't give permission to Code Magic to add webhooks. I think it's it's created automatically. Just sometimes it happens that the webhook is not created. So now I hope it will work. If I will create some new branch. I will randomly change something. Okay, so here is my branch. I see. Yes, that's definitely what I want to do, to merge it, to create pull request, to merge it to master. Okay. I think it's already created. Check. Okay. I just didn't reload the page. Yeah, the build is actually started automatically on my pull request. And then if you check into AppSource, the branch which you use it is fetched. Then your source branch. Then it's merged. Basically, here I added 5 lines to my readme file. And tests are run on these merged files. OK. Nothing bad found. Everything is fine. No publishing. Yeah, that's it. The same will be if I enable push command. Let's say for default workflow. On every change, I will trigger on push. So keep in mind that if you have several workflows that and they have the same branch pattern, they will be run, like all of them, those which correspond to your branches. So if you put like every branch, then it may annoy you at some point. But yeah, let's just push something to master. Same simple change. Okay, you see that the build is started automatically because we added build trigger. And it's just good that you don't need to worry about even starting builds. You may not even go to CodeMagic website. And basically, if it's good, then it's good. If it fails, you will receive Slack notification or email notification. And, yeah, you will know that it happened. Okay, let's move next. Okay, I'm going to add driver tests. I'm just going to use default ones. Let's copy. Source. Also add the dependency. To popspec YAML. Yeah, what else? We need to create new folder. Is the program to run? See, and the tests which will be run on that program. I hope it was correct. Basically, you can name it as whatever you want, but you will just specify target afterwards. So that's my main app, which will run my package. My counter. Okay. And so here it's nothing happens. You just run your main app. And tests, which gonna be run on it. I'm not going to go into details here. The main thing is just to try that it will work. Let's commit. Oh, okay. I will disable this automatic triggering. Because I need to first specify my driver. Let's first delete it. Okay. In workflow, what I need only my driver tests, I'm not going to build anything else. I just want to verify that my driver tests pass. So I'm going to disable all the builds. And again, we don't have anything set in publishing except a female. iOS Simulator will be run faster than Android. I just see. Okay, so branches fetch it automatically. If it didn't happen, you can refresh and select workflow, driver tests. Okay, now it's going to take some time. Because to run application for driver tests, you basically need to build it first. And if you do drive tests and then build, it means that your application will be built twice. Okay, at this time, iOS emulator is launched. Simulator, sorry.
While this is running, if anybody has any questions, feel free to ask.
Okay, then let's be it running. I just go to show. What else? If you want to run tests on a real device from obvious device form, first you will need to have access key and secret access key. You get them after you register. And yeah, you don't need to pay immediately, but you pay afterwards based on how much of devices you use. It's 0.17 cents per minute or something like this. And it's not connected to CodeMagic. We just use this AWS device farm through Sylph tool. Sylph is like a wrapper which allows to CI services to use it. Here is nice instruction. If you want to try it just locally, and then afterwards, if you want to enable it for CI, but here is everything is quite easy. Let me pass my keys. Then if I want to specify what I want actually do, I upload a Sylph YAML file to my repository in the root. And here I specified it like I want that device in that pool and I will run that test suite. Basically on this application, I will run those tests. And yeah, if you didn't add this Sylph YAML, we will add it by default and we'll run only Android build, Android device. Oh, I think tests test finish it. No. Okay, let's be running. Yeah, I'm lucky because I named my tests just main and main tests. Otherwise, it wouldn't work, and you would need to set target like driver main dart. In my case, it's the same because Flutter drive command set it by default if target is not mentioned. But okay. Nothing changed here. I'll just wait till it will finish. Okay, something is going wrong, probably, because the simulator is found and the application is built and what do you mean exactly by settings? I think no. There is. I think Misha, can you help? What's the default iOS emulator and the Android emulator used? Ah, okay. I think. Ah, yes. I just don't remember exactly where it's mentioned in documentation. Maybe I did something wrong here. Let's just try again and ensure that test driver main dart. Yes, driver branch. Okay, just to not waste time, I will set another OS. The only thing which I'm going to change here is to change it to OS device farm. I have concurrency too. So I can run two builds together.
I have a question concerning the configuration file, the YAML file. So you downloaded the YAML configuration. Is this configuration then available to the UI as well? So how do you do changes? Only so if you download it in YAML, the changes are only affected in the YAML configuration. Is that correct?
Yeah, it's basically converted in one way. You can convert your UI settings to YAML, but you cannot convert YAML settings to UI because there can be everything, like any kind of scripts or whatever you can use. And if you want to change something, you just change file directly here. It's basically, if I, I cannot do just like this. But
so this configuration is no longer available in the UI. You can only select it there.
No, it's available. You can run. You can still run from both UI and YAML.
Oh, so you can see configuration in the UI.
Yes. Basically, you just add your CodeMagic YAML file to repository.
Okay.
And I didn't change anything here, but you can delete and add whatever you need. You can even build React Native or something. Like, it's not like Flutter is just commands. You can use everything what you need. I will just check out the master. Then if I want to start new build, I can go to my, let's see, branches, YAML branch. And if YAML file is found, you can select this workflow. And yeah, here I have the same four workflows, which set here.
Okay, and then, if you select, let's say if you select something like that, you can click on the gear and see the configuration in the UI, or you just have it there to be selected?
No, I, in UI I can only select.
Oh,
okay. I cannot modify the file like which is here immediately. I can just change something in UI and copy it to make changes to my repository.
Okay. All right. Thanks.
Yeah. So in many cases, it helps to keep the history of what was actually done, like which keys were used. And so, and of course, you can just copy this CodeMagic YAML to another repository and without need to manually create workflows in UI. Let's check. Okay. I think it's still was because I didn't set target in drive command. Okay, I will cancel those builds. But yeah, that's driver tests, the common Flutter drive target and the device which I'm using. And yeah, you can see all tests passed. Again, we didn't do any publishing yet. And you can also download Flutter drive logs. They will not say anything new, just so you can keep the history as well. Okay. Yeah, that's what happens when you have build triggers. It's better to be careful. I don't need to build everything. Okay, that's my driver test AVS. I think at some point the SILF YAML file was generated. I think it's actually here in the full log when it's will be available, but for this test it will take like 12 minutes, I think. Oh no, it's timeout. Okay. I hope it will start at some point. I just return a bit later to it. Then you have to move to Kotsanin.
I have before we move on to the. So I remember this test magic app that you could, you know, add your device and test. Your device, is this something that is still supported?
It exists. It's not in developing currently. It's basically done. It works, and that's it. We have plans on renovating and okay. Basically start to support it like with new features. But so far, you can use this magic to see your builds and to write feedbacks. It's application from Nevercode. You can upload it from Google Play, just as it is, or write in Slack and to upload it from TestFlight for iOS, because iOS doesn't allow other automatization applications to be in App Store.
All right, thanks.
Uh-huh. And yeah, about code signing. So it's needed to ensure that you are actual developer, that certificate authority, which is App Store or Google Play, sign it, like your information that you actually legitimate developer and it can be trusted, and that the software wasn't changed in any way, like the state is the same. And how's it done? You have your content file. It may be some image or application or basically whatever content you need to pass. You calculate hash of it with some hash function, usually SHA 256 and RSA. You specify this algorithm to calculate cache. Then you encrypt this cache with your private key and send your public key to together with this encrypted cache, which is actually is digital signature and the content. And if the person on other end can decrypt this hash with your public key, it means that your private key match and it can be sure that the file was encrypted with your private key, that it's actually you, the one who sent it. And if after decryption, the content, like this actual hash is the same as if the hash calculate JSON content, like immediately, if it's the same, then the content wasn't altered, and you can be sure that nobody took it, like on the media, on the way to the receiver. And basically the same is done for code signing of applications. The difference is not just one digital signature is created, but many of them in different parts of code, and all your assets, like pictures and music and other files, are signed digitally. And basically, if you change like even minor thing, you add the new line, then a hash is not the same already, and your iPhone or Windows or whatever platform will not allow, because it will say you cannot trust this app. Or if your public key, which is sent together with this application, cannot decrypt the signature, it means that it was encrypted by somebody else, like not the sender. And again, like you cannot trust this person, and you won't install it. So at first, iOS code signing, it's much more complicated than for Android. Basically, it's still not that complicated, but for Android, it's much more straightforward and easy. For manual code signing, you need your code signing certificate with password. If you use some password and provision profiles, what is it exactly? I will tell a bit later. But another option is automatic code signing. So if you have your Apple Developer Portal credentials, you can add it. Let's see. Okay, I think it won't work, but whatever. Okay, I have a portal connected, but I will just disconnect it, connect again. Okay, it's valid. And where was my application? Okay, I don't want to run anything. I just want my iOS build. In release. Then those provision profiles and certificate is automatically fetched by CodeMagic from developer portal, and you can use it to distribute. Like development is when you have specified devices to which you want to install. And oh no, wait. Yeah, it's through third-party providers and App Store if you want to upload it to App Store. And bundle identifier, it's the name of your application. Basically, let's just go into the details. So we, it first to create a certificate, you need to create a sign-in request. Basically, in this point, public and private key are created, and then to your public key, you add your email and username, and submit it to Apple Developer Portal. It signs it with Apple Developer Portal Certificate Authority digital key and sends you back. So basically, you have the same information, also with added validity data, like it will be valid for 1 year. You will have back this information signed by Apple Developer Portal. But then if you want to encrypt your application, you need your private key. And then this private key is added to your certificate, which is sent to you. And it's stored in P12 format, which is basically a bundle of keys. There can be many of them. And then another thing is you need to have provision profile. It's all the information about your application. A bundle identifier, it's the identifier which you use. Let me show. I think it will be easier just to find this. In your project, in iOS folder, runner Xcode project, you can see your product bundle identifier. You can change the name, or you can change it to the provision profile which you have. But yeah, it creates app ID, like your team ID and app bundle identifier. Also, list of entitlements is like the list of permissions and the list of functions on the hardware which your app will be allowed to use. And devices list is optional if you want to distribute this application to not App Store, for example, like all the devices, but to some concrete devices, to your beta testers, or I don't know, to your relatives and so on. So all of this together, this certificate creates provision profile, which captures the information about your application. Let's just see how it's done. I open keychain access. Then request certificate from certificate authority. Basically, this Apple Developer Portal is free to use. You just register your Apple ID and then register on Developer Portal. But if you want to publish to App Store, you need to enroll yourself to Apple Developer Program, which is $99 per year. And so I just don't mention anything here because I save it to my disk. Okay. I will close all of this. Now I will go to my Apple Developer Portal. Here I have the list of my certificates, IDs, and profiles. So identifier, it's the information of your application. I have already created this simplest counter with this my bundle ID. But how it's done, it's basically you create what you want to do. And yeah, it's just app ID, it's whatever description and bundle identifier. You also may not mention the exact name of your application, but use wildcard, which is like any name, but it will be able to use just limited amount of hardware resources. And you choose which services you want to use. And yeah, just create, but I will not create because I already have created. So all of this information is stored in list format, and it is our entitlements together with app ID. If I go to my simplest counter, I can see that my prefix is my team ID and bundle ID is the one which I actually will use in my project. Then I need to create certificate. I think I will delete this one. Create new. I will show the distribution to actually on App Store. So I will choose iOS distribution. There are 7 types of certificates, what you need. And you cannot, for example, upload a desktop application with iOS distribution certificate. Because here are also different services, like for push notifications and voice over IP and so on. So just continue. I choose my file. A certificate request which I created. And continue. So that's it. Now I can download my certificate. It's the same information together with, again, like when, like a due time to my certificate. But now it's just sign it. When I will add it to KeyStore, it will find automatically my private key with which my certificate request was generated, and it will be added to this certificate. Like I open it, and now I have my private key attached. So these two keys will create, if I export already not certificate extension, but B12, because there are two keys stored, and I want to use some password. Wait, and basically allow to create. Okay, now I have my certificate for iOS distribution. Now I can proceed to my provisioning profile. I think, yeah, let's create another one. So, okay, here is, again, if it's development or distribution, I want to use distribution to App Store. And I use my app ID. My simple counter, so that's the app ID, team and bundle. Again, certificate, which I want to use with it, and for its name, let's see, use distribution. Ah, okay. I already created one. Okay, it's generated. Now I can download it. That's my provisioning profiles. And these are basically two files which I need to sign my application. So again, that's the structure, and I will just add them. Okay, I just sign. Manual. I used password, so here you need to specify password as well to open this certificate, and my provision profile. Again, if this provision profile will not match the application which I'm actually building, then it will fail. If it's expired, it will fail. If something is wrong with certificate, it will fail. So manual is kind of, you need to be aware of everything which can go wrong when you sign application manually, not automatically. Okay, let's try to build. Okay, yeah, it will take some time to be faster. I will tell immediately about publishing. So that's App Store Connect, from where you can upload applications to App Store. That's the one which you need to pay $99 per year, which is so much more than Google Play. I already created my simplest counter application. Basically, I would want to delete it, but you cannot delete anything which you already uploaded. So this garbage is going to stay here forever. But Apple is quite strict about what you publish. And if you will try to publish something like totally innocent like this, it still will reject, saying that the application is too narrow. Like, you need to add some features to make it actually useful. It's actually also much longer. But here I have. One build. But okay, I already. Okay. Sorry, I didn't enable no code sign. That's I know. No, wait. So sorry, everything was okay. I just, no, false alarm. Okay, let it just be running. For publishing, you need three things. I will go to Android CodeSign in a bit later. It's this to be enrolled into Apple Developer Program. And you need Apple ID, app specific password, and app ID. So app ID is, this one, or immediately here. Go to App Store Connect. Okay, you will not be, like, you will be notified that something is needed. No, it's not Apple ID. It's App ID. And Apple ID, it's mine. And app-specific password, it's the password which is not your Apple ID, but something new generated, which you can always revoke or like change at any point of time. You need to go to Apple ID. Okay, I'm going to be fast. You need to generate a password, whatever the name I will give to it. So that's my app specific password, which I can always revoke, which you can just use like any number of them. Okay, it's updated. Let's just see if the build finished normally. Okay, everything is fine. Building iOS, everything is signed. And the archive is exported. And that's your ready app in IPA format. Let's just start it. I think it's already quite late to go about Android code signing, but for Android, it's much more straightforward. You just create new key with key tool. Before 2017, it was that you create key, it's uploaded, and if you lose the key, then you have no access to your application anymore, and you need to create new one. But after 2017, there is a Google Play app signing feature that creates the certificate, like creates the key on Google server, and you have no access to it. You just use this key store as the file to verify that you actually the one who you are, and the application is signed afterwards. And if your upload key store is compromised on you lost it, you can just create new one, like revoke that one and create new one. And for publishing, it's again, everything is easier. You just download this key file, JSON credentials from your Google account, and add it. Let me show. So for Android code signing, it's key store, key store password, key alias, and key password. It's same as okay, that's it. I created my key store. My key store password is debug password. And there is information which I entered. So that's the one which you create on your machine, or even here in build scripts, or if you don't do it, it will be created automatically. And you add it to key store, add passwords here. And in Google Play, you just choose. Wait, I need to enable Android. Oh, finish it. Okay, it wants code signing. So basically here you just upload your credentials JSON and choose the track, if it's alpha, beta, or internal. And that's it, the publishing. Let's just check. What's our build result? Expert succeeded. Okay, it's I'm amazed, but for iOS it's unbelievably fast. Just 2 minutes for actual IPA file. I know what's wrong. I think I didn't enable the actual publishing. Okay, so that's basically it. I'm glad to answer some questions, because obviously I covered not that much as I would want to tell about.
Yeah, so I have a question. So with the setup in CodeMagic, you can actually split your workflow in different workflows. So you could actually split it for an Android publishing and an iOS publishing. If you only want, you know, to publish whenever changes in your plugins, you know, respective plugins are effective.
Yes, and it's a very common practice to keep separately.
So what's the common practice of doing so? So you are you having on tag you publish, and on, you know, in master you just, you know, go ahead and only test. What's your common pattern that you see in using?
Usually it's almost like everywhere it's debug when you don't publish anywhere, but you create your applications and you sign them and you run tests on it. It's basically on every push, on every commit, it's run, and you just ensure that your branch is green, that nothing fails. And then Android publishing and iOS publishing are separately, because, an example, if for some reason your Android build failed, you don't want iOS build like to be published, or you want to keep them together. Usually one don't need so many workflows, and basically your production and debug and for experiments something.
Okay. And another question that I have is that I usually bind the build number, so I manually assign the build number to the index of the work, the workflow that I am using. So the problem that arises is that if I change the workflow, if I clone the workflow, if I want to switch something else, the build number needs to go up, but it starts again from one.
In CodeMagic, we keep the history of builds. Like basically, each build has a new build number, and I will show. You specify it's in your Flutter build command.
So in Flutter build command, I specify that the build number, and I assign it to the environmental variable that exposes this index. So basically, my build number is the index of the workflow.
Yes. And that's a build number. It's like you don't need to specify it manually. It's create like the variable created by CodeMagic.
Yeah. And it's always, appended. So it's always, you know, it gets incremented.
Yes.
But
yes.
The thing is that what I do is that, let's say I want to change the a common thing that I have is that if I change the workflow, or I clone the workflow, or I, you know, switch whatever, and I want to switch workflows, the new workflow starts from one again. So I have to assign an offset in order to pick up the builds. Mm-hmm. Is there a way to do that, you know, in a configuration way in the CodeMagic ecosystem, or is it something that I have to, you know, do it myself manually?
So far as
the start of the index number, let's say, or setting a number that always increments
It's only we setting some offset like for now.
Okay.
But basically, it can be changed. I think at some point. Yeah, but so far, if you want not from the first, you need to add some offset to your variable.
Yeah, for build name, I see that someone posted, Lena posted, you can have a build name. Yeah, for build name, that's resolved. I always use the tag. But for build number, I need an incremented integer or an incremented number. Anyway, so it's an offset. Then I keep using the offset until further notice, let's say.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, thanks.
Oh, wait, maybe it's a little different. Oh, that's version number. Okay, I already will not try again, but basically I needed to specify my build version. Yeah, to increment my number. Okay. That's when you do something in a hurry, it won't go well.
All right, everybody, and does anyone have any questions? Any other than me? If not, then we can wrap it up.